Sometimes our rich people are in the places we call home. Places like Baltimore. Last year, Laura McGee was a new admission intern at Montclair Christian School. The surrounding neighborhood faces the problems of many inner city communities. Poverty, violence, drugs. The school was opened by Wilkins Avenue Mennonite Church in 1998. The staff are considered missionaries. Any kid is welcome at the tiny school of 45 students, and tuition is only $25 a month. About halfway through the year, Lauren realized the simplicity of her mission. The students didn't need her to be a professional missionary. They weren't asking her to give them anything. They needed her to support them. They needed her to be their friend. A young boy, Chance, was still healing from experiencing loss at a young age. As Lauren spent time with him in classes, field trips, and talks, she saw God working in him. When she left, Chance asked if they would meet again. She said, absolutely. That's what made Lauren love Baltimore so much. Children like Chance are looking for someone to be the instrument God uses. That's all. Now Lauren is going back to Mount Clair Christian School. This time, she's joining the staff as the middle school supervisor. Because she's learned that missions isn't an event. It's life. God led her to share life with this community, alongside future leaders, creators, and mentors, like Chance. Now, Lauren is choosing to launch into life on mission.
Thank you. thank you so much for the reason that we gather. It's all because of you. We sang those words. And oh, to be like you. Thank you that you left your place on high to come for sinful men to die. That's us. I pray that those words that we sang, that Jesus was, is, and always is going to be our Savior. Thank you for the opportunity, God, to look into your word. Please use this time for your honor and glory. Help our hearts to be ready soil for growth in our lives, and may your Holy Spirit do your work. In Jesus' name, amen. It was the summer of 2014, and there was a young woman and her fiancé. They had a big decision to make. They were newly married, they were getting married, and they were from different states, one from North Carolina, one from Pennsylvania, and, sorry if my mic's cutting out, try again. One was from Pennsylvania, one was from North Carolina. They were graduating, they were getting married, they had met in college, and they were deciding where they were going to live and where they were going to work. They had a big decision to make. What have been your biggest decisions in life? What have been your biggest decisions in life? Have they been relational? Some relationships we choose, whether we're going to pursue a certain relationship, some relationships we're born into, or that are difficult to avoid because of where we work or where we live or go to school. But there's a lot of small decisions around big decisions, really thousands of decisions we make every day that connect to some of the bigger decisions. Maybe it's an occupational decision that has been a big decision, or several of them have been big decisions in your life. I can remember after I had graduated from college and interviewing for a teaching position at a small Christian school. I remember praying on my knees in what our family calls the blue room in the house we grew up in, because it was a school I knew really nothing about. I didn't know anyone there, and I had this idea of Christian camping still in my mind, and I wasn't sure if that's what I should do or not. It was a big decision for me. Relationally, I wear in my hand a piece of metal that reminds me every day of the most significant relational decision I've made other than my relationship with Jesus. Educational isn't up there, but it relates. And, are you going to stay in school? Are you going to give your best effort in school? What kind of effort are you going to give? And what every young person, junior, senior, gets sick of being asked, what are you going to do after school? But you know, it's the question you kind of have to answer at some point. Educational decisions, financial decisions. Can we actually buy this house? Can we buy this car? Can we pay this bill? And if so, how? Maybe it's a health decision that has been really significant for you. There's this treatment or this procedure. Should I be doing it? My age, is this something I should know the side effects the risks. It's a big decision. How about spiritually? Spiritual decisions that you've made in your life. I can remember as a young person sitting at McCaskey High School in an auditorium at a Christian rock concert where Milan Lefebvre described some of his life story of being with heavy metal bands like Black Sabbath and AC/DC and playing with them, and then somehow in his life meeting Christ and how his life changed. And then challenging us, seated there in the audience, to make some type of decision for Jesus. And I felt like I had already made that decision, but he kind of offered us an opportunity to recommit ourselves. I can remember raising my hand in that McCaskey Auditorium. There are a lot of factors that influence big decisions. What are the results, the consequences? What kind of time frame do I have to make this decision? Sometimes it's a long time frame. Sometimes it's very short. Who else is affected by these decisions? The fear of the unknown. These all go into some of our decision making. Talked about the summer of 2014, and I was speaking about a co-worker of mine, a young lady who she and her husband decided to move to Pennsylvania. He was from this area, from Lancaster, and she was from North Carolina. He was from a family that had a small business in this area. I'm going to try to do something. Fast forward, and how I got to know her is because she found meaningful employment at Friendship Community and is a coworker of mine. Just recently, she shared that her and her husband and now they have a one-year-old son, another on the way. They have had to make the hard decision that they are planning to move back to North Carolina, largely because of things with the family business didn't work out quite as they hoped. It's a big decision for them. Each of them have to find new work. There's a lot of questions that they're facing. Big decision. How long do you have to make the most important decision? How long do you have to make the most important decision life? Well, we don't know. I would propose that our most important decision is what we do with Jesus Christ. And we don't really know how much time we have to make that decision. Now, we're here on a church that worships Jesus on Sunday morning, so many of you, most of you, have made that decision and are like those thousands of decisions that we make each day, trying to continue to make little decisions each day to remain faithful to a decision you made. Like I try to make decisions each day in faithfulness to my commitment to my wife. But we don't know how long we have to make that decision. Deciding about Jesus is life's biggest decision, and that shows up in our scripture reading today. have a Bible, I'd invite you to turn to John 18. John 18. So this account is of Jesus' arrest, his trial. Kind of broke it up into four sections of verses, and I thought the middle two I could ask for some other people to read, just for a different voice to being heard. I did already ask Chad, who was willing. I didn't get another person yet, so if someone else would be willing to read, you can be ready for that third spot in John 18:19-27. But I'll start with the first one, and Chad will read the second one. So John 18:1-11. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with the disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side there was an olive grove, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Jesus came to the grove, guided a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas, the traitor, was standing there with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." "I told you that I am he," Jesus answered. "If you are looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Just two things before we go to the next section. I thought I'd point out, it impressed me that the scripture tells us clearly Jesus knows all things. He knew what was going to happen to him, and he was facing it. You may remember last week we talked about how a big change was coming. A big change was coming for Jesus. A serious time of struggle happened for him in the garden. But because he surrendered to God's sovereignty, he was able to face that with confidence. And we read it now in John's account of how he's doing that. He's going and saying, "I'm he. You came looking for Jesus of Nazareth. Here I am. Let's do this, what needs to be done." The other thing that was interesting to me is this use of the word cup. So Jesus uses the word cup, and it reminded me that, you know, here in this section he's saying, "Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" Representing the cup of suffering, the cup of the cross, the cup of him at one point saying, my God, why have you forsaken me?" To be forsaken by his Father was the cup. And it was that same word, cup, that he had just used at the Last Supper. As he passed the cup around, and said, gave a new meaning to their celebration. And this cup, that wine, was a remembrance of his blood being spilled. Okay, let's go to John 18:12-18.
Then the detachment of soldiers with its commander and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it would be good if one man died for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple were following Jesus. Because his disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard. But Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. "You are not one of his disciples, are you?" the girl at the door asked Peter. He replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and officials stood around the fire they had made to keep warm. Peter also was standing with them, warming himself.
Thank you. Would someone be willing to read the next section? Thank you, Luke. I'm going to make a few comments before you read that. So one of the things as I was reading that, I was asking myself, so it sounds like Caiaphas is the high priest and Annas is the father-in-law of the high priest, and I was trying to figure out why they would have taken him to Annas, and I did a little bit of study about that, and I want to read a couple things. First, I learned that the Pilate, who we'll read about in a minute, this book says he was probably a governor, but maybe a lower-ranking governor called a prefect, and the prefect was allowed to appoint the Jewish high priest. This meant that the ruling Jewish families of the province were willing to cooperate with him. This prefect had few troops of his own, and in times of unrest, he had to turn to the other provinces for help. So there was this kind of, even though the Romans and Jewish people were very much in conflict, this hierarchy of the high priests, they were some kind of relationship with the Roman government, because the Roman government actually put the high priest in place. And in my NIV study Bible, it talks about Annas in particular had been been put out of his position as high priest by the Romans in AD 15. But was probably still regarded as the true high priest. In Jewish law, a man could not be sentenced on the day of his trial, on the same day that his trial was held. Two examinations, this one mentioned only by John, and that before Caiaphas, may have been conducted to give some form of legitimacy to what was done. So, if I understand that correctly, Annas was the high priest. Something went wrong in the relationship with the Roman government. He got kicked out, but the people sort of still saw him as the high priest. And so Caiaphas is the new official high priest. And there's also this rule about you couldn't convict a man, have him tried and convicted on the same day. There had to be two different sort of meetings or whatever, so some of those things may have played into why he was taken to Annas first and then to Caiaphas. Okay, and Luke, if you could pick it up at verse 19 to 27, please.
The high priest therefore asked Jesus of his disciples and of his teaching. Jesus answered him, "I have spoken openly to the world. I ever taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together, and in secret spake I another. Why askest thou me? Ask them that have heard me what I spake unto them. Behold, these now know the things which I said." And when he had said this, one of the officers standing by struck Jesus with his hand, saying, "Answerest thou the high priest so?" Jesus answered him, "I have spoken evil, bear witness of the evil, but if well, why smitest thou me?" Annas there sent him bound unto Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They said therefore unto him, "Art thou also one of his disciples?" He denied and said, "I am not." One of the servants of the high priest, being a kinsman of him who here Peter cut off, saith, "Did I not see thee in the garden with him?" Peter therefore denied again and straightway the cook grew.
Thank you. just pass the mic over to Eric Kelman. One of the other accounts describes that time when Peter gave that third denial, and it actually describes, I think I wrote down where it is, yes, Luke 22:61 tells us that the Lord turned and looked straight at Peter on that third denial as the rooster crowed. As we're reading through this, you might notice that many different people are making a decision about Jesus, what they're doing in Jesus, what their perspective, what their understanding is about Jesus. And that continues here. Verse 28. Then the Jews led Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, the Jews did not enter the palace. They wanted to be able to keep the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." They don't really answer the question, but Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," the Jews objected. This happened so that the words Jesus had spoken, indicating the kind of death he was going to die, would be fulfilled. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked, "or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "It was your people and your chief priests who handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jews. But now my kingdom is from another place." "You are a king then," said Pilate. Jesus answered, "You are right in saying I am a king. In fact, for this reason I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" Pilate asked. With this, he went out again to the Jews and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him, but it is your custom for me to release to you one of the prisoners at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" They shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in a rebellion. Let's stop the scripture reading there. Pilate certainly didn't seem to care about fairness. He just wanted to avoid Passover. It doesn't seem like he cared a whole lot about truth either. But before he knew it, Pilate was faced with the most important decision of all time: what to do with Jesus. And sooner or later, everyone make that decision. Sooner or later, everyone must make that decision. What to do with Jesus? Is Jesus a source of anger and frustration? A hassle to be avoided? Or is he the way, the truth, and the life? It's important to carefully think over. It's the biggest decision you'll ever make. What about Jesus do we have to decide? Well, what we're going to do with Jesus. By meaning that, we can say, what are some of the options of what can we do with Jesus? Well, like Judas, we can take a position of rejecting him. Judas's perspective may have been related to power, related to the zealots and wanting to overthrow the Romans and being in charge. And Jesus just didn't seem to be fitting into that mold. He was talking about suffering, and it didn't seem to fit what Judas's plans were. And of course, he was influenced by Satan, but Judas's response is to reject him. And really, that was the response also of the Jewish officials. They were the church people. They were the board of elders. They were the leaders. And they rejected Jesus. Maybe he was cute as a 12-year-old when he knew the scripture so well. But he once stopped talking about God as his father. They rejected him. The crowd rejects Jesus. When being offered him as to be released, they reject Jesus. And in other accounts we know where they shout, "Crucify him." Another possible option of what we can do with Jesus is deny him. So Peter is someone like us who is wanting to follow him, but when faced with difficulty about that, being identified with Jesus, says, "I don't know him. I'm not a Christian. No, that's not me." Find yourself in settings where you're quiet or you don't associate yourself with things of church or God or something of that nature. Are there ways that you or I deny Jesus? Another option we can have is that of Pilate. He's avoiding the hassle of dealing with him. So Pilate's in a difficult place. He's trying to keep peace in a region where a lot of the people don't like him. He doesn't have many soldiers. He's trying to smooth things out. He doesn't want to address who Jesus is or whether it's truth or not. He just doesn't want a riot to happen. You kind of avoid Jesus in your life. You just want to kind of go on with it. Whatever your plan is, whatever that next big decision you have in life, your pursuit, your goal, your dream, do you avoid Jesus as Lord? Or another option, Pilate kind of alludes to it. He doesn't really go there, but he asks a question: what is truth? That's an option that we can have, to honestly search for truth. I looked up a couple of stories of people who have come to Christ, and there was one about, you can see the picture of a guy, but his name is Dr. Hugh Ross, who, as a young person, a teenager, he got really into studying the stars, and asked tons of questions, and read books, and went online and learned about everything he could. And he wasn't from a Christian family, didn't know any, hadn't been raised in the church. Gradually, really through creation and the study of the sciences, he came to read scripture. And he read religious books from all different religions, but it was only the scriptures, the Holy Scripture, the Bible, that connected with his understanding and what he had learned of science and what he had seen in the natural world. And he became a follower of Christ. He took his pursuit of Pilate to ask the question, what is truth? And ultimately, we can accept him. We have the opportunity to accept him as a source of all truth and to listen to him. Christ says, in fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. So as we conclude, what will you do with Jesus? Everyone has to decide. No decision, a no decision or an indecision is really a decision of no. If we just aside, we're going to avoid the question. Really, where our answer is no, Jesus. I'd like us just to turn to that first one, Romans 14:10. We have a Bible, Romans 14:10. And I'm going to start reading just a few verses back. It's 7, Romans 14:7. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. Verse 9. For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. You then, why do you judge your brother? Or why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. So then, each of us will give an account of himself to God. I'd like us to say that phrase in verse 10, for we will all stand before God's judgment seat. So if we could just say those phrases, repeat after me. For we will all, we'll break it up in three parts. For we will all,
for we will all
stand before
God's judgment seat.
Each of us here today, everyone out there, who's, wherever they are, we're going to stand before God's judgment seat. What will you do? What will you decide today? This afternoon, this week, this year, this earthly lifetime, there's thousands of small decisions that we make every day in light of our big decision. What will you do with Jesus? I'm going to close in prayer right now, and I invite you to close your eyes. And I am going to give you an opportunity to raise your hand if you want to make some type of decision. Just like I described briefly in my growing up. If you're here this morning and you have never made a decision to say yes to Jesus, to say, Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins and I want you to be the Lord of my life. Please forgive me. Thank you for dying on the cross for me and rising again. If you have never done that before, I invite you to make a decision today and to raise your hand. Not for me or anyone else, but to God, to say, God, I want to be your child. If you're here this morning and maybe one of those other descriptions of people and how they responded to Jesus has been convicting to you, perhaps you've been rejecting Jesus in some way, perhaps you've been avoiding Jesus, just avoiding the hassle of him in your life, not being willing to be sold out to him and allowing him to lead and guide every area of your life. I invite you to raise your hand. God, I thank you for the opportunity you give us. Thank you, Lord, that it is your heart that every person would come to know you. But you also describe the road as being narrow, and that many people miss it, reject it, avoid it. I pray, Lord, that we would remember that we will all stand before you. We will either stand before you as being our judge, or as you being our Lord and our Savior. Be with each one in our lives as we make those big decisions, this biggest decision, and those thousands of small decisions daily to live for you. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, I kept my eyes closed. I have no idea if anyone raised their hand or not, but if you want to, if you did, if you want to talk to anybody about that, I'm certainly willing and count it a privilege to talk with you. Or if there's other people in your life who can be an encouragement and a support to you, I encourage you to do that. Same would be true of the Easter program. There's opportunities to help and serve. If you're interested in helping in some way, please let me know.
This is Nina Brown. I would like to ask all of you to pray for Scott and Alexis, our granddaughter. They've made a big decision. They've separated. Scott went back to his dad in Indiana, Pennsylvania, and Alexis is with her parents in Camp Hill. I know God is with them. Pray that they will hear his voice.
Eric Fisher from here in church. Mom's doing well. She's over her sickness. I was interested with Wilbur this week going for propane tanks. That was an interesting episode to see how they do things over at that place. That was really something to see all the tanks and everything and what they do over there.
Shared it in my Sunday school class and in prayer this morning that the family of Michael Sharp has been on my mind. He was in the news a couple of weeks ago. He is a young man of Mennonite background and was a UN, United Nations peacekeeper, and went into the Democratic Republic of Congo in Central Africa several weeks ago with another UN worker and some translators. And they disappeared. They were abducted. And just on Tuesday, their bodies were found. Three of the bodies were found, and they were in a shallow grave. So he gave his life. But I would just pray that the seeds that he has planted would be making a difference. It's an area where there are a lot of rebel and militia groups fighting each other for some of the natural resources there. And Michael would go in unarmed and try to meet with the leaders of those groups and try to encourage them to seek a way of peace. Michael's father is a professor at Heston College in Kansas.
Stand for the prayer, please. Thank you, Father, for being with us. Thank you for your love for us. We pray for these needs, God, and many of them represent a lot of hurt. And just put them into your hands and ask for your help, ask for your comfort, ask for your sovereignty to do what only you can do, and that is to bring good out of things that seem bad. We pray for the country of India, many children, families who are impacted by this government decision to not allow aid through faith-based organizations like Compassion International. We pray, God, that that their faith would be strong, that you would provide for their needs, pray specifically for Arsha and pray for her and her family. We pray for Scott and Alexis. We thank you for them. God, we pray in this time of hurt and struggle that they would seek you and you would help them to see a path forward. Pray for those who surround them. We pray for the family of Michael Sharp and the other workers who were killed recently in efforts to bring peace. We pray, God, for comfort for them and for a continuation of their efforts and work, God, and that you would bring peace to a hurting world. And that people would recognize you as a source of true peace. Thank you for Eric, and thank you that his mother's doing well. Thank you for the opportunity to switch some propane tanks around and how that can help financially. Thank you, God, for the decisions that we have to make in life. Some of the decisions we have to make in this region of the world are so maybe frivolous compared to some people, some places seeking to know how they will survive. But God, we all, regardless of our affluence or poverty, we all stand before you, and I pray that you would help us to choose you daily and continually. We thank you for the opportunity to celebrate around a meal. We do that in recognition again that there are people hurting and hungry. Help us to be grateful and to remember that every good and perfect gift comes from you. I pray these things and we go.